Thank you, sir. I think so. The most of the investigations ends here, and everybody wants to wrap up because FFA is done, ICG is done, and OCTA is done. But still, I think there is something left, and I would come on to a non-invasive technology, which although I mean not very frequently used, I think either the patient's money is finished by that this time, or you know we are just supposed to write for academic reasons. So autofluorescence is one of the non-invasive technology. I think it cannot be though replaced with any of these techniques, but yeah, it does act as a supplement and at many places where actually we can avoid the invasive diagnostics. So first described by Delory in 1980s, it had been hidden and it was not used because of availability issues and technology. And it's what exactly it is a density map of the lipofusin in the retinal pigment epithelium. So what exactly how it emits its autofluorescence is a fluorophore which absorbs a photon of the excitation wavelength. It elevates at an excited level, collides at that level, and then when it comes down to the base level, it emits lower energy and longer wavelength as it transitions back to the ground state. That is what is the autofluorescence which it emits. So the main ocular fluorophores of the RI would be lipofusin being the most dominant one. Then we have the A2E, melanin, and others like rhodopsin and extracellular material. Lipofusin being the most dominant, it is its properties come from the base retinoid compounds, and it increases with age, degenerative disorders, AMD, macular dystrophies, BES, Stargardt's. So all these conditions probably can be monitored with our technique of autofluorescence. A2E being the little less dominant and being most in the peripheral distribution is not very important in that point. Again, melanin, it's again primarily in fovea, macula and periphery. It absorbs the short wavelength and excitation beam and decreasing the overall autofluorescent signals. So RP melanin acts also like an antioxidant and it is the hypoautofluorescent pigment. Again, coming to the rhodopsin, again, one of the important pigments. So we can see here, there's two scans here, but that's the property which rhodopsin emits. So it is sometimes because of the continued exposure, it leads to increase in the autofluorescence signals called the bleaching effect, which can be seen very well seen here in the second picture. Yeah. So other fluorophores would be vitelliform lesions and optics is driven. We are all are aware of that. So let's come on the imaging systems available for this autofluorescence. So we have the basic fundus camera with the spate filter, that is a red altered filter. We have a confocal scanning laser ophthalmoscope. We have optos ultra-wide field systems. So we have a few advantages and disadvantages of all these systems available. Advantages of fundus camera with the spate filter, mainly because they have converted the filter into red shifted, so it doesn't interfere with the other structures of the eye, which actually gives autofluorescent. So it can be used with FA because the excitation light is different from the angiography. It uses red shifted wavelength, so it is different. And it is more comfortable for the patient as it is not the SLO-based technology. It's not the blue light, which basically is very disturbing for the patient. However, it is poor contrast and no real-time averaging. So coming to our latest available spectralis, that is Heidelberg, we have this is there is a real-time averaging with that. There is a high contrast, high resolution, but unfortunately, again, the light here used is blue, so we cannot really precede it with the angiography. Coming to the optos ultra-wide field, very brief acquisition time is what the advantage is, but again, no real-time averaging, poor contrast, and it is available with other. We can take color fundus here, red-free, FA, ICG. So what are the basic divisions? There's a classification given by Yang et al. That is autofluorescence into increased RP lipofusin, which is lipofusin opacities and RP tear. Then we have subretinal deposits, maybe because of vitelliform or central serous retinopathy. We have window defects, white dot syndromes, central serous retinopathy, then macular telangiectasias. Other autofluorescent materials, we'll obviously that the extracellular material will we count optic distrusions and astrocytic hematoma. Coming to the hypoautofluorescent, we have either the reduced pigment, that is absent RP lipofusin, or maybe because of the blockage of that material. So if it's reduced, it may be RP tear or atrophy or media opacities, or blockage may be because of pigments, media opacities, again subretinal hemorrhage or fibrosis or a scar tissue. So as we divided hypo, you know, the autofluorescence into three: hyper, hypo, again iso. And coming to just see that, so this is one of the major classifications given for geographical atrophy only on the basis of autofluorescence. So that is how, where it is used, and it should be used where we don't really need to do any kind of invasive, investigations. So let's see the few cases here. So this is one of the cases which we can see. I think a lot of us may miss on clinical examination the fundus, what we can see, and on the autofluorescence, it's a very clearly defined geographical atrophy seen here with the hyper autofluorescent areas. So can we compare it on the OCT? This is a scan of 3-4 years followed up. So the lower scan is like 2013, and then we have a 2017 scan, but honestly, none of us would be able to differentiate it so clearly that is there any difference in the scan? Is there, has it increased? Has it, patient always says that, you know, my vision has dropped, but there is no, you know, we really don't have an answer to it because it's a geographical atrophy. We just say, oh, it will remain the same. It will be like that. But let's see here. So we have a serial photographs here of autofluorescence. So you can see over the years, 2013 to 2017, how the, you know, it has increased. And so here we can obviously tell our patient that it has increased to from 2013 to 2017, and that is the reason of a further progressive visual loss. So that's where it is. We can monitor the geographical atrophy over serial photographs. Again, case two, similar, something very similar. You can see this in 2015, and then again something in 2018. You can see the increase in the atrophy area. So a well monitoring of geographical atrophy can be done with this non-invasive technology. Again, one of very commonly misdiagnosed entities, that is a papillary edema. We see that, and we probably think it to be like, you know, write MRI, we ask for symptoms for any kind of papillary edema. But here we can see there is optic disc drusen very clearly seen on autofluorescence, and we can always supplement it with the OCT as well as B scan to make sure about it. Again, a case of CSR, we can see this is acute CSR, we can see have a leak, but again, this is a hyperfluorescent material which is there and with a central halo of hypo. A chronic CSR, very characteristically seen like a teardrop sign or a gravitational tracts which can be seen. This is all hypo autofluorescent areas. We can, again, prognosticate the patient as per your vision and as per the treatment protocol. One of the cases of chronic CSR, similar pattern, but it is something different. It is again hypo autofluorescent with although a central hyper autofluorescent, which is mostly coincided with a chronic fluid which is sitting over there since years and years. A Stargardt's disease, you can see a very characteristic findings of flecks which are there, hyper autofluorescent flecks. But although there is a very significant sparing of the peripapillary area, that is the most important feature of diagnosing it, Stargardt's on the autofluorescent. That's another one very good entities nowadays which we diagnose very often, that is adult onset vitelliform disease. That is, so noting on the fundus photo, we can see a small area which is autofluorescent, although there is still a vitelliform lesion here which we can probably see the deposits out here, and well documented and supplemented by the optical coherence tomography. So yes, here I think a lot of us will miss a lot of findings here. So I just gave a clinical fundus photo, but let's see how it comes out to be. So when we did an autofluorescent, we can see there's a lot of deposits here, which is, well, again, it's over the years, it has come down. We can see, we can monitor the whole disease. So there were deposits subretinal, again here, there was deposits here with the vertical scan, but when we monitored it over the years, it has gone down. A very classical melanocytoma, we can again, it's a hypo autofluorescent lesion, which is very, again, beautifully characterized, and we can again monitor such kind of lesions over the autofluorescence. Pattern dystrophies like Drusen-Peters, again, an area of hyper autofluorescent with the surrounding hypo. We can see all these drusenoid, which may be missed on clinical fundus photos. One of the very important, I think everybody would say here, that if I would ask that only looking at this picture, which patient would have the less vision? I think everybody, if I'm not wrong, would see here, because there is a small island left here of the fovea, But well, when I did an autofluorescent in this patient, there was unfortunately the other side. The other side had a small island which was actually missed on your Kiro fundus photo. So this was one which was an island, and the vision in the right eye was much better, which when I saw clinically, I could not make it out, and I was wondering why patient is saying me left, right eye, and it was like this. Again, a case of post-choroidated atrophy, which has been monitored over years, 2015 to 17, which has stayed like that. There is no changes, there's no border, which is hyperautofluorescent. I'll come on that. So this, again, one of the fundus pictures, which can be clearly missed if we don't do an autofluorescent. An autofluorescent giving a very hyperactive hyperautofluorescent with a hypocentral, which actually is, again, a lesion of choroiditis. So yes, we can monitor your all serpiginous choroiditis. We can see here all the lesions are hyper, and in the other eye also there is a hyper lesion, but over the years it has come down. But these are not still finished. They can be active. This is the sign that it comes down, the hyperautofluorescent, but they're still present. But if you see this now, they have come more blackish now. But still there are few lesions which are still can be active, can get active. One of, again, similar cases, serpiginous. This is hyperactive. All the lesions are hyperautofluorescent, and over the years, they have resolved and become hypo. So yes, to monitor the activity of serpiginous, we can, instead of doing always, we just go ahead with doing an angiography. I would suggest we can do just, autofluorescence can give us briefly. Again, same lesion. This was a head lesion. We can see all black hair. We can see here there is still an activity here on the edges, which is hyperautofluorescent. And one of the cases where we can again monitor is earliest sign we can see on bullseye maculopathy. So that is the classical, which is a foveal sparing bullseye maculopathy. So to conclude, I think yes, it gives information on the metabolic state and overall health of RP, the autofluorescent. Yes, it may detect abnormalities which are maybe sometimes not detected actually on angiography, and it may elucidate disease pathogenesis, form genotype, and diagnose, monitor disease, and evaluate the novel therapies. Thank you. Thank you.